Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to today's seminar. My name is Greg Carty. I'm the Associate Dean for Research. I'll just be introducing our speaker very quickly, but I want to welcome you on this beautiful spring day. I'm really looking forward to this talk. This is Rebecca Hasson, who received one of the Marie Hartwig School of Kinesiology Pilot Award grants. She was actually originally funded in 2018, and as is typically the case, it takes a while to get all the data together, and of course, COVID came along. But she has now, one of the most exciting times with this grant is to hear about the results. So we're really happy for that. The only thing I'll say is, before letting Rebecca have the floor, is that we're going to use the Q&A function so you can be typing in questions at any time that you want. And at the end of the talk, I'll sort of curate those, go through those questions, and we'll have at least probably 10 minutes for questions with Rebecca. So very excited to hear her talk on classroom-based strategies to reduce disparities in physical activity among children with asthma. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Greg, for that wonderful introduction, and thank you everyone for attending today. We're really excited, my students and I, to share with you some of the work that we've been doing over the last few years in classrooms and in the laboratory as it relates to promoting youth physical activity. So for those of you who may be less familiar with the type of research that we do in the Childhood Disparities Research Lab, there's three main components that we focus our research agenda on. One, we aim to identify disparities, racial ethnic disparities, and obesity-related metabolic abnormalities. We also try to understand why do those differences occur. And then finally, we really try to not just study the problem, but to try to find solutions to the problem through physical activity promotion. We primarily focus on physical activity, both in understanding how does physical activity work to improve health outcomes in children, but also how do we translate it to community settings, both in the school and in the home environment, to enable children, to all children, to engage in health-enhancing physical activity in their own environments. So today's presentation is really going to focus on the funding that we received from the School of Kinesiology, and I want to thank you all very much for funding this, because it gave us an opportunity to reach a population that does have low levels of physical activity, and that is children with asthma. And this is very close to my heart, as I actually struggled with asthma. I had severe asthma growing up. I grew out of it a little bit, but still struggle with it a little bit in my older age. And so understanding how can we promote physical activity in that population was very near and dear to my heart. But one of the big take-home messages I think you're going to get from this presentation that I hope to convey is that moderate intensity intermittent activity is safe and enjoyable form of exercise for all children, including children with asthma. And I'll tell you a little bit later in the presentation why this is so important, because usually exercise is a trigger for asthma symptoms. And so it's been very difficult to figure out what's the right prescription, how do we do it safely, particularly in community environments. And it was through this funding that we were able to do some testing in the laboratory, as well as testing in classrooms, that enabled us to understand or come to the conclusion that yes, it is safe if we do it in small bursts, as kids like to naturally move in that pattern. So the evidence to support these conclusions will come from four different studies. The first two studies that I'm going to present to you today are previous research that led us to this point, where we wanted to look specifically in children with asthma. And then I'm going to give you some preliminary data that we started to collect. The COVID pandemic interrupted it a bit, but I still think we're going to have some interesting findings from that data set. So when we think about promoting physical activity, this is probably one of my favorite slides, favorite pieces of data. This is data from David Bassett's lab, to where he did a review of all of the different studies looking at the metabolic equivalents of how much physical activity are kids accumulating in different environments. And you can see from this infographic that was taken from a paper published by the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation in 2013, that there are multiple ways in which we can help children to be physically active. But many of these, we have a particular interest in low-income children or children who live in low-resource communities, and many of these opportunities are not available. So we know that in low-resource schools, daily PE is not required, and there actually is no requirement for physical education in elementary and middle schools throughout Michigan. We know that after-school programs can provide physical activity, but they don't always. We know that safe parks are not always in major supply in low-resource communities. We know that it may not be safe for children to walk to and from schools. So we have really focused our attention on the classroom. How do we promote physical activity in the classroom where all children spend the majority of their time in that setting and usually in a seated position? This idea came to us by working with two architects that worked in the College of Architecture and Urban Planning, and they were really interested in how do we redesign classrooms for movement. This was back in 2013 when they were really interested in helping to change or eliminate childhood obesity from a different perspective. First Lady Michelle Obama had her Let's Move campaign going, and so they really wanted to partner to figure out how can we create these new classrooms that allow for children to move and learn simultaneously. So we came up with a bunch of questions together in order to make that happen. And from a kinesiology standpoint, there were several questions that we needed to address in the laboratory first before we actually went into a classroom setting. And those were, what is the smallest dose of exercise that might elicit health benefits? Because we know that teachers aren't going to give us 30 minutes in a row, continuous minutes to do any sort of physical activity. But if we break it up into small chunks, is that more feasible for a classroom environment? We know that from the adult literature, when you introduce physical activity, there are usually compensatory responses that occur. That as an adult, when I start training for my half marathons, I usually become a couch potato when I'm not exercising, and I will change my physical activity patterns in different domains throughout the day. Same thing with eating habits. That usually when adults start exercising, they will sometimes eat back those calories. Now it's usually intensity dependent, but we wanted to know, will kids compensate in their physical activity away from school? Will they compensate in terms of their eating behaviors that may offset what we're trying to do in the classroom? We also wanted to know, do children even like to move in these small bursts? Is this gonna be something that's enjoyable for these individuals? From the architecture standpoint, they were interested in understanding how much space does a child need in a classroom to move safely, because that is one of the largest barriers to classroom activity. And instead of building these spaceship classrooms that most schools can't afford, can we promote, just rearrange the furniture that's already there that allows classrooms to be functional for both movement and learning? So we went to the literature to see what is the smallest dose. And there was a lot of work coming out of David Dunstan's lab that was thinking of this concept of breaking up prolonged sitting. And there was data to suggest that these small bursts of activity combined with interrupting prolonged sitting was associated with improvements in glucose control, insulin responses, also thinking about blood pressure responses. And these papers were in adults, but then there were also subsequent papers in children that also looked at metabolic outcomes and particularly as it related to glucose control. So we had some idea to suggest that 2 minutes is a sufficient dose to see some metabolic health improvements. So what did we do? We went to our laboratory and we used a similar model, and we had 39 children come into our laboratory on 4 different occasions. One was a sedentary condition. Then we had them come in on 3 other occasions where they did low intensity activity breaks, moderate and high intensity activity breaks. And so 18 minutes of sitting and then a 2 minute activity break, 18 minutes of sitting, 2 minute activity break for an 7.5 hour period. It was very easy to recruit for this study because this was during the weekends. And so it was free babysitting for our parents who were involved. But it was a fun study because we were able to have the kids come into the lab and then to assess some of the questions that we were interested in. We particularly as it related to dietary intake, we gave them a standardized meal the night before, standardized breakfast, standardized lunch as they were exercising throughout the day. And then we gave them a large compensatory meal. So it was about 70% of their caloric intake. We gave them a very large meal to see if they would eat all of that food, if they were compensate in their food consumption when they went home after each one of these exercise days. We also had the participants wearing an accelerometer in the laboratory and for 3 days after leaving the laboratory. And they also did food records so that we could see if there was any long-term or I guess short-term compensatory behaviors after each of those exercise conditions. So Molly, who was an undergrad at the time in our laboratory, she really wanted to understand, is spontaneous activity, does it change in terms of the different amount, intensity of exercise, and do these interrupting these small bursts of activity, are we going to see any compensation, and is that intensity dependent? And as you can see down here, you have the sitting, low, moderate, and high conditions, and the white bars or the white space represents how many calories, physical activity, energy expenditure inside the laboratory. And then the gray bars represent how many calories they were burning through physical activity outside of the laboratory. And what we noted was that yes, there was a significant difference in the amount of calories or energy expenditure inside the laboratory, but we did not see a significant difference outside of the laboratory. So we did not have any data to suggest that there was any compensation going on, which was a good thing. So our individuals or kids who were coming into the lab that were exercising at a high intensity, burning about 270 calories, they still continue to exercise when they went home. The kids who were sitting all day, and again, each kid did every single condition. When they were in the lab sitting, they also continued to burn more calories outside of the lab. This red line indicates if there was compensation, you would expect that the total physical activity energy expenditure would be the same across all conditions. But at least in this high intensity condition, we saw that the kids on average burned an additional 150 calories on that day, which was kind of exciting. Tiwa was interested in looking at the food compensation, dietary compensation. And so he looked at both appetite sensations and food intake. And again, across the four different conditions, we didn't see any changes in appetite sensation. What you see over here is a hunger visual analog scale. And from the very beginning in the morning till about 4 o'clock in the afternoon, this is when they first come into the lab before they've eaten anything, that their appetite or their hunger was pretty high. Then after eating breakfast, you see it goes down, then it goes up right before lunch, and then they eat something, it goes down. And then right before they leave the lab, it's up higher. But what you can see is that there's no difference across conditions, no matter how much many calories they were burning inside the lab, their hunger stayed the same throughout. And you can see this is the area under the curve for the same data. And when we look at total food consumption, so how much food were they eating? Breakfast was the same across conditions. Lunch was the same. And even the ad libitum dinner was the same, little variation, but it was about the same across all conditions. It was not statistically significantly different. What you do see, however, is that the kids were, if you put more food in front of kids, they're going to eat more food. So this increased food consumption was really a function of how much food they were given, but not a function of the exercise conditions that they were in. When we think about exercise enjoyment, we saw across the different conditions, we measured exercise enjoyment after 10 activity breaks and then after 20 activity breaks. And you could see that it really did not vary that much across conditions, but we did see that it was a small but significant significantly higher physical activity enjoyment during the exercise conditions as compared to the sedentary condition. And the sedentary condition, what those interruptions were, was they were playing video, playing on an iPad, doing little 2-minute video games. So this was a really cool finding that we saw that the kids actually reported that they enjoyed physical activity slightly more than they enjoyed the iPad condition, which is usually counterintuitive to, we think that children really like to play on their iPads more than physical activity, but in a head-to-head comparison, the enjoyment actually was a bit higher in the exercise conditions. Another cool finding that we had was when we looked, we about 30% of the children that came into the lab were overweight or obese. And when we looked at their intact mood, so how do they feel during, we asked them, how do they feel while they are exercising throughout the day after each activity break? And this scale is from positive 5 to negative 5. The normal weight individuals, they were exercising, they reported a 4 out of 5 throughout the day. And so pretty good mood. But then for the overweight or obese individuals, theirs was a little lower at the beginning of the day. But over time, we saw this significant increase over time throughout the day. And this was great. We were really excited to see this. Now, why might we see this improvement in mood with each subsequent bout? And again, this was during the high intensity condition. We were believing that this is an improvement in self-efficacy, their confidence to do the activities. Actually, we were thinking was improving their mood throughout the day so that by the end of the day, they were had the same mood or affect as the normal weight children. So to answer our questions, we didn't see any compensation in diet or physical activity, and children appear to enjoy and have positive affect related to intermittent activity. We also published a few other papers, again, related to blood pressure, related to exercise fatigue and math performance. And all of these were, again, giving us more insight as to this might be a great dose or type of exercise the kids will enjoy, can do in the classroom. We had 2 children with asthma in our studies for this one, and that this was not one of the primary outcomes that we were looking at in these studies, but we didn't have any issues with our children with asthma, with the exception of the high intensity exercise. So I'll come back to that a little bit later, as we're gonna see some differences in affect when we get to those higher intensity activities. But with the lower and moderate intensity activity, there was no complications with the children with asthma. So for the Sean, who was doing the architecture designs, he was able to come up with floor plans, as you see over here, for teachers to redesign their rooms to allow for more space. These pink areas indicate where kids can exercise in the classroom. He took measurements of each of the classrooms throughout Michigan and developed these different floor plans. And he also did calculations to figure out how much space does each child need. And they need about 36 inches. This is pre-COVID. They need about 36 inches to move safely in their classrooms. So with this information, we were ready to go into classrooms, but most of the teachers that we talked to figured that their classroom would look like this, that they had this image of kindergarten cop, and their classroom would be crazy and kids would be running all over the place if we were gonna try to introduce 20 intermittent activity breaks into that day. So as we were talking with our teachers, we adapted or translated our findings from the laboratory protocol to a school protocol to see if there would be a more feasible way in which we could introduce physical activity in that setting. And so one of some of the main things that we changed was the dose. So instead of having all these different varieties of intensities, we settled on moderate to vigorous. Instead of having 22-minute activity breaks, we said, let's try 10 3-minute activity breaks. Schools are recommended to provide 30 minutes of physical activity. And so we said, why don't we try to get all 30 minutes in the classroom and see if that is feasible? So what did we do? That we developed IMPACT, so interrupting prolonged sitting with activity. And it was our goal to provide teachers with the necessary resources to lead their classrooms in 10 3-minute activity breaks throughout the day. And so we tested this in 3 different classrooms across the state of Michigan, 1 high income, 1 middle income, and 1 low income. And it was a 16-week intervention, feasibility intervention, to where we were going to implement 10 activity breaks, or ask the teachers to try to implement 10 activity breaks throughout the day. And we wanted to see, did it work well in all different types of schools? And what you can see here are basically the findings from our first classroom-based study, that teachers, they actually preferred a little bit longer activity breaks, 4 minutes. They were able to implement 5 activity breaks. We had really quick transition times, which worked really well for the teachers in terms of classroom management. And this was the best finding that the teachers really liked, was 99% of students were back on task within 30 seconds of completing an activity break. Their confidence was really high in the students, the enjoyment level, and 85% of the kids were exercising at a moderate to vigorous intensity. And we measured this through direct observation as our students went into the classroom, did observations in the classroom, and were able to quantify how hard or how intense their movement was. Were they moving and how intense was their movement? One thing that we did notice is that, again, as we were trying to target low resource schools, we did see differences in intervention implementation. We gave the same resources and training to all the schools, but we did see disparities in terms of some of our outcomes. So there, our low resource schools did implement fewer activity breaks, lower student intensity, lower enjoyment, and some perceived disruptive student behavior. So we went back to another school to actually try to fix some of those problems. And it was in working with Andy Eisman, who is an implementation scientist, who introduced us to that field of how can we eliminate some of these implementation barriers by adapting our program so that all children and teachers will be able to implement at a high rate, and then students can get that physical activity in their classrooms. And so using implementation frameworks, we designed some strategies that helped to directly reduce some of the barriers that we noted in low resource schools that then improved implementation outcomes. In this school, our teachers were able to implement 5 4-minute activity breaks, which enabled our students to accumulate 20 minutes of physical activity. And so the great thing about this is that now we have a program that works in high, middle, and low resource schools that enables children to get 20 minutes of physical activity in that space. And so if we go back to what the literature says, we are meeting, even slightly surpassing what is seen in high resource schools or generally around the country, and that we have a program, we're using a slightly different dose, but that enables us to get 19 minutes of physical activity. So if I'm talking to any of the exercise physiologists in the room, they might be thinking, well, is 19 minutes a sufficient dose to elicit any sort of health benefit? And I had the pleasure of presenting at the American Diabetes Association with Catherine Davis a few years ago, thanks to my faculty mentor, Jeff Horowitz. And as I was presenting my data, she presented her data right afterwards from this JAMA study that she was able to publish. She did a randomized controlled trial where she did look at exercise dose and diabetes risk in overweight and obese children. And she noted that 20 minutes of exercise did elicit improvements in fitness, improvements in adiposity, visceral adiposity, and insulin resistance. So we do believe that 20 minutes is a sufficient dose that you can induce some metabolic health outcomes or benefits. And that's actually what we are working on an R01 submission now to do a randomized controlled trial in classrooms really focused on improving metabolic health with 20-minute dose of exercise. Well, after I spoke, we had all of our data collected and we were excited that now we have this intervention. I was introduced to Toby Lewis, who said, "That's great that you have an intervention that works, but does it work in children with asthma?" And this was actually what we've heard from a lot of our teachers as we were working with them, is that they were nervous to do this type of activity, even if it was in small doses, in their students with asthma. And as you can see here from this slide, there are a lot of asthma is a pretty rampant problem, and that there are more than 6 million children across the United States that have diagnosed asthma. And that's about 1 in 12 children. We know that it's much higher in low resource ethnic minority communities, and that it's about double in African-American individuals compared to non-Latino white children. So this is a problem that we haven't really been able to address yet. And so we were interested. Toby wanted to promote physical activity in this population, but she didn't really know how to do it safely. And so we started working together or thinking about how might we be able to promote physical activity in this population. We also, and myself as a childhood obesity researcher, realized that there is a strong link between asthma and obesity. And we see that there is quite a few behavioral pathways that have been predicted to be associated with linking asthma and obesity together. One is decreased physical activity. So there is, some people have predicted or have hypothesized that it is the not engaging in physical activity for whatever reason in children with asthma, that that lower physical activity is contributing to their obesity rates, and it's also contributing to their exacerbated asthma symptoms. We also have seen in some of the literature that eating a high fat or low fiber diet or a high inflammatory diet, it may also be contributing both to the obesity and asthma. So our first foyer into this area of looking at asthma, physical activity, and again, thinking of obesity as kind of a side issue, was to see, is this really true? Do we see this interrelationship between asthma, obesity, dietary intake, and physical activity? And are these two factors causing, or one of the important moderators between the relationship of asthma and obesity? So an undergraduate student working in my lab, Matt Nagy, we collected data in 195 African-American youth, where we had looked at the association. We had collected baseline data. It was an observational study looking at physical activity measured by accelerometry, dietary intake measured by food records. We had measured obesity, and asthma status was assessed using a questionnaire. And he ran different analyses to show that, yes, there was a relationship between asthma and obesity in this population. And as individuals who were reporting that they ever had asthma were actually three times more likely to be overweight or obese compared to those who did not have asthma. He did show that the children with asthma were eating a higher inflammatory diet, but neither physical activity or that inflammatory diet was associated with or was explaining this asthma and obesity link. That, and the literature really points to that there are other factors, more like environmental pollutants, psychological stress, vitamin D deficiencies that may be contributing to this increased relationship between obesity and asthma. And it may not actually be related to physical activity or nutrition, or maybe that's an indirect pathway by which these things are connected. So once we found these findings to see that maybe it wasn't the asthma that was contributing to this link, the physical activity that was contributing to this link, we decided, well, let's actually try to promote physical activity in this population. Because we know that regular exercise is associated with better asthma control, and then it's also associated with better weight maintenance. But the problem is that engaging in exercise can actually be triggered, can trigger an asthma attack, and that asthma symptoms typically occur within 5 to 10 minutes when you start exercising. Toby was really trying to figure out how can we promote physical activity if every time they're going to start exercising, 5 or 10 minutes into that exercise, they are going to start experiencing asthma symptoms. So given all the work that we had done in intermittent physical activity, I suggested, well, what about intermittent activity? Why don't we try to promote physical activity in these short bursts? Kids naturally like to move in those patterns anyways. So when we did some preliminary data in the studies, we didn't really have any incidents with or asthma symptoms in the laboratory with the two kids that we were testing that had asthma. So why don't we try that out? And so she thought that that was safe, that that might actually work. And so that is how we came up with Impact Asthma. And so Toby and I worked together to go into another school with a high asthma prevalence to really compare student exercise intensity. Would children with asthma engage in intermittent activity? Would they engage at the same intensity? Would there be any asthma symptoms that occur? What about after exercise? Would asthma symptoms occur? And would we see any improvements in physical activity or confidence in this population? Because if children with asthma can tolerate intermittent physical activity breaks, then integrating classroom activity may be an effective strategy, not only for all kids, but particularly for this special population that has many fewer resources or opportunities to be physically active. Both teachers, parents, PE teachers, a lot of health professionals are nervous to prescribe exercise, even though the American College of Sports Medicine says that it's absolutely safe if it is monitored. So with the help of Toby, we went into another school. This is a school in Detroit. that was a large school, again, another low resource school that had a predominantly ethnic minority population. It was a 20-week intervention, and 31% of the students in that school actually reported asthma symptoms or a history of asthma, which is quadruple the national average. So there was a really high rate of asthma in this school. And so what did we do? So again, we implemented using this new 5-4 minute activity breaks. We did direct observation to assess children. So you can see here, this is Lexi in a classroom as the children are doing the activities on the video and following behind her, and other students would do scans to one, see how many children were exercising during the activity break. Two, to see what was the intensity of the exercise. And then three, to monitor any asthma symptom occurrence during or after exercise. So any wheezing, any coughing, any shortness of breath that is reported, that was documented. And then how that any symptoms were resolved, that was also documented. And so they monitored during exercise and then up to 15 minutes after exercise. We also, again, asked questionnaires. So physical activity enjoyment was assessed using the PACES questionnaire. And then a one question self-efficacy scale question about how confident are you in your ability to continue exercising or getting 30 minutes of physical activity a day. We also had our teachers answer end of study questionnaires to also assess their perceptions of any sort of student asthmatic responses that may be happening during activity breaks. So what did Lexi find? Lexi took the lead on this analysis, and she was able to determine, here's the 20-week study. And you see in the black circles is children with asthma. That's the asthma data. The open squares is the children without reported asthma. And surprisingly, interestingly, we were so shocked. We actually saw that the children with asthma were exercising at a higher percentage of children with asthma were exercising at the right intensity, moderate to vigorous physical activity. And if you look over here, this is the area under the curve, or the total amount of physical activity participating in moderate to vigorous physical activity, leisure time, and sedentary, that there were significant differences between the children with asthma, that they were exercising at a higher intensity compared to the children without asthma. And so we were definitely doing the happy dance. So was Toby, because we were excited to see that students were actually participating and they were doing it at a higher intensity than the children without asthma. When we think about enjoyment and confidence, we see that both children, this is average change in enjoyment from the middle of the study. We asked at the midpoint of the study and then at the very end, 20 weeks after, their enjoyment of activity increased in both groups, but it was not significantly different and there was a large variability. But what we do see is that there was a significant increase in physical activity confidence in the children with asthma, and really no change in the children without asthma. So again, we see this idea that their confidence is improving as they're able to engage in physical activity in the classroom. And that might be explaining why we see higher participation rates in the children with asthma. And this was totally counterintuitive. We did not think that we thought that maybe they might be a little bit lower in terms of their participation rate or similar, but the fact that they were higher, that was really exciting to all of us. And so what we did find out is, in terms of asthma symptoms, we had very few symptoms of asthma that occurred. So out of 294 observations, there was only 6 instances of asthmatic symptoms, and that was coughing that were observed. And these symptoms were self-resolved, meaning they didn't have to use their inhaler. It didn't result in any sort of exercise-induced bronchial constriction or asthma attack. And so this was another great finding. One thing that we did see, though, is Mr. Reyes, he is our all-star teacher, and he loved implementing the activity breaks, that he would actually do them 5 times in a row. So much for interrupting prolonged sitting, but he did actually get the 20 minutes of physical activity, and the kids loved it, and they would ask for one after another. He did actually report 5 instances where kids opted out to not participate. And it may have been because he chose to do one 20-minute continuous dose of exercise rather than breaking it up into smaller doses. So that was one thing that we noted from this, is that we may paying attention to the dose is going to be really important for children with asthma. Maybe not so much for other teachers as they're implementing their physical activity breaks in a typically healthy population, but for children who might have lung capacity issues, paying attention to that dosing will be really important. But we didn't know that for sure. And so we ended up submitting, Toby and I wanted to know, is that actually true? Like, if you compare 20 minutes of continuous activity versus 5 4-minute intermittent activity breaks, can you enhance cardiorespiratory fitness to the same extent while minimizing exercise-induced bronchioconstriction and inflammatory responses? Because it really is thought that there's increase in inflammatory responses during exercise that's leading to the bronchioconstriction. And do you see different responses in intermittent exercise compared to continuous exercise? So we submitted this R21. It was scored not in a fundable range, but we were interested in, we'll probably resubmit once we move out of this COVID pandemic, because this is a very hard population in our current environment to do any sort of testing with, because they are very high risk. But this, we submitted that and we hope to resubmit it. But what we did do in the meantime, while we were waiting for the scores, is really focus on understanding exercise tolerance and perceived comfort. So could we, since we saw such success in the classroom, if we go back into the laboratory, can we test other types of intermittent activity? So is it just with doing a Just Dance video, or what about resistance training? What about just doing walking? Are there other types of intermittent activities that children with asthma can do and enjoy? And so because we had a few more pennies left of our grant, we asked for an extension to use the monies so that we could actually conduct a laboratory study. And that was called Exhale, Exercises for a Healthy Lifestyle and Enjoyment. And what we were really interested in was examining differences in exercise tolerance, exercise enjoyment, motor competency in children with and without asthma. And we also wanted to see if enjoyment, really looking at, and that's what I'm going to present today, if enjoyment, exercise enjoyment and attitudes really changed or were different between these two different groups. So we recruited 60 boys and girls to participate between the ages of 8 to 16 with and without asthma. We unfortunately were only able to collect data in 37 of the participants, but we still have some preliminary data that is giving us some interesting findings. So what did we do? We brought children into the lab again. Somehow we love these all day studies. Where we bring the child in at 9 o'clock in the morning, and then they leave around 2:30 in the afternoon, and we do some baseline testing. We make sure, particularly with the children with asthma, that they have all of their asthma medications and that they had approval from their pediatric pulmonologist before they came in and were allowed to participate in the study. They would do 5 different exercise conditions throughout the day that just lasted about 5 or 6 minutes. And we would take measures of RPE, ratings of perceived exertion, mood, heart rate, and then enjoyment. We also took measures of motor skills, motor competency, and took measures of exercise tolerance. We haven't analyzed that data yet, and so that data is forthcoming. But when we think about what were the exercises that we actually used, we use standard exercises that are typically used either in a school or a gym or in a home setting. So the 6-minute walk test, which is usually kind of a cardiovascular, submaximal cardiovascular fitness test, resistance exercises that were taken from SPARC. That's more of a school-based physical activity programming, a 5-minute moderate to vigorous like classroom activity break, a Just Dance video, just like they would do in a classroom. We set up an obstacle course in the laboratory and gamified it, because some of the data that I didn't present is that we have added game design elements to our interventions to make it fun, add a little competition, add small prizes, and this really helped to enhance enjoyment and participation in students. And so we had an obstacle course, and then finally the 3-minute step test. This is also another sort of fitness test. It's a little more rigorous because you have to step up, step down at a pace that is synchronized with the metronome. This was order was standardized, so it was not randomized because we were nervous that the children with asthma might induce an asthma attack if you start out with the step test. So we used this order and so going from more moderate intensity activities to more higher intensity activities. And what were our outcomes? So again, if this is just a sample exercise condition or exercise break right here, you'll see that once they started, heart rate was taken throughout the exercise break. And then at the midpoint, we would ask the children, how hard do you feel you're working? And how do you feel right now? And then 15 minutes after the exercise, we would ask them about their enjoyment of activity. So Anna, an undergraduate working in our lab, she is taking the first stab at looking at this data, and it's very preliminary. So I'm not going to present any statistics on this yet, because we want to make sure that we've done our done the interaction terms, the main effects. And so we just decided to just present the raw data so that you all could get a sense of the trends in the data that we're seeing. But this is just the basic heart rate data during the different activities. And as you can see, during the first three activities, the heart rates were in more of a moderate intensity condition or moderate intensity zone. Whereas the gamified obstacle course and the 3-minute step test were more in a higher intensity, still moderate to vigorous, but more higher intensity zone. So the first outcome is the enjoyment. So that's what we were really excited about looking at, is enjoyment of physical activity. And again, this measure was taken after 15 minutes after each one of these exercises. This is presented by asthma status. So without asthma is the dark bar, and with asthma is the light bar. And you can see that in general, they were pretty high. So again, the pace goes up to 5. So you're seeing fairly high scores of enjoyment across all the different activities. You do start to see differences a little bit in this gamified obstacle course, to where the children with asthma had slower enjoyment compared to the children without asthma. This is likely because this was self-paced and the heart rates were really high on this activity and children were really pushing themselves. And so there might have been a situation where the children with asthma, they just really didn't like the competition piece. Now, they still reported high levels of enjoyment, but just not as high as without asthma. So it'll be interesting to see if these differences are significant or not. When we look at RPE, we really did not see any differences across particularly across the low or moderate intensity activities. We do see higher RPEs and slight differences, but not substantial differences in this area. For mood, we did not see, again, across the lower intensity activities, really not that much different. But when you get to these higher intensity, particularly that 3-minute step test, we saw a much lower in-task mood, how they felt while they were exercising. They did not seem to like this constant higher intensity, redundant, repetitive exercise. But what was interesting is that if you look at their heart rates during not that much difference during the moderate intensity exercise, but we did see lower heart rates during these higher intensity activities. And it doesn't appear to be matching really what their RPE was. As in doing some digging in the literature, this may be a function of their asthma status. And some of the exercise tolerance data may give us a better idea for this, or their lung capacity, where we measured their lung capacity through spirometry, because when one symptom of an asthma attack is lower heart rates. And so this may be, we may be seeing symptoms here of beginning symptoms of bronchial constriction. We didn't actually have any asthma attacks in the participants that came into the lab, but this may be some indication that there might've been some bronchial constriction, but we'll be able to determine that more so once we have the spirometry data analyzed. And so that's exactly what Toby's looking at. Toby is looking at if there's any differences in lung capacity, FEV1, exercise tolerance with these different activities. And again, Leah Robinson here in kinesiology is looking at differences in potential differences in motor competency, as that might be predicting some of the psychosocial outcomes that we saw related to exercise. If children don't know how to move, then they will not, and there is data to suggest they are not going to engage in movement and they're not going to enjoy it as much. So some of the activities that we saw, maybe some of those differences might be related to motor competency. So when we think about, put all of this together, what do we think all of this data is saying as it relates to asthma? Is that here, this is from the CDC, and this is the Coordinated School Health Program and Strategies for Addressing Asthma. We see here that there's many different ways in which the CDC has developed a coordinated plan to address asthma in school settings. And there's both health services, physical education, all of these different trainings to really make sure that children or students with asthma can live healthy and productive lives, because we do know that asthma is one of the number one things that keeps children out of schools. But you don't see anything about classroom activity. And so one of the things that I think comes from this study that we're starting to get evidence in support of is that intermittent activity may be one way in which we can introduce more physical education and physical activity into that school environment, in the classrooms in particular. And we are also currently using intermittent activity to promote family physical activity in the homes during this current COVID-19 pandemic. And as many of you may know, we've had an opportunity to partner with Detroit Public Television to where we're promoting physical activity in the home environment now using an 8-minute bout. So these exercise videos are approximately 6 to 8 minutes. So it's a little bit longer, but we're confident that children with asthma can do them because we have marked them in terms of whether it's moderate intensity, high intensity. They are at home in a safe environment where their parents can help them if an asthma attack occurs. But providing multiple opportunities for children with asthma to be able to be active in different environments is the long-term goal. We've also, during this time, since there's been such a push to promote physical activity in the home, we've been able to do some, Toby and I have been able to do some advocacy work through the American College of Sports Medicine to really advocate for quality indoor air. So as we're asking everyone to be physically active at home, we need to make sure that if they can't go outside to exercise, that they can exercise indoors and they have quality indoor air, because we do know that that can be a big hindrance for children with asthma to engage in physical activity in the home. So I just want to finish with the slide that we started with in terms of, while I am focused on classroom activity breaks, I'm not the only one in our school that's working to promote youth physical activity, that there are a lot of individuals. So we know that Dale, Leah, and Wayun are doing a lot in the PE domain and adaptive PE to promote physical activity in that arena. We know that Natalie and Nick Tobier, Natalie works in parks to promote physical activity and green spaces. Nick promotes a lot. He's actually in the School of Art and Design and finding creative ways to support physical activity going to and from school. Karen Pfeiffer, who is a professor at Michigan State, she's doing a lot of after school programming, and she works very closely with Leah, and they have an RO1 together where they are promoting both motor skills and physical activity in after school environments. And then with our two new synergy hires, implementation science and decision making, I think that we have a great team here at the University of Michigan to really help to promote physical activity in schools, in communities, in homes. And we have a great team to really move the needle on physical activity promotion for children and adolescents across the state. So I just want to leave you with this slide right here that just shows how our programs are being used both in classrooms and in home environments. And I just look forward to all of your questions, as it is the goal to give every child, irrespective of their ability status, an opportunity to engage in health enhancing physical activity. And that's one of the goals of our lab. And we look forward to partnering with others to make that happen. I just want to say a final thank you to our funders, particularly the School of Kinesiology, who has enabled us to complete this research, particularly the asthma-based research. And thank you for your time and attention.
Great. So I'm I hope you can hear me. You can hear me, Rebecca? Great. So this is Greg again. So again, I encourage you to use the Q&A function to ask some questions. I have one here. I'm going to ask one first. Real quickly on the low resource schools, you talked about that you went back and made some adaptations. I was just curious, what were the most important and effective adaptations that made the most difference that you learned?
So there are three major adaptations that the teachers, we made a ton, but I think the ones that were the most important was enhancing the teacher training. So to give the teachers more confidence in their ability to implement activity breaks in their classroom and making it easier. We had developed this 200-page a compendium of different activities that they could use and put into their curriculum. And it is now a coffee mug holder because it took up too much time. It would take teachers 20, 30 minutes to figure out which activity breaks. So we actually started developing videos or using videos that were freely available. We made sure that they were at the right intensity and would send those videos so that all the teachers had to do was just click the button and actually implement the activity breaks. And then I think the third one was definitely classroom management strategies. So we have developed these different posters, and this comes out of the School of Education, that helps them improve that transition time. So if the activity break was going to, if they took too long for the kids to transition back to their seat, it took too much time away from the instruction and the teachers didn't want to do it. One of the best ways to help to bring the kids back to focus and attention was actually taking their heart rate immediately after the activity break, which helped us understand what was the intensity of exercise, but it helped to calm them down, refocus them. And that's, I think, what helped with the 99% of students were back on task within 30 seconds.
Great, thank you. And so I've got a couple of questions already. Mike Vesia has a two-parter, so I'm gonna give you the first question and then we'll give you the second one from Mike. So Mike says, great talk. Have you looked at the effect of impact on motor skill learning?
That's a great question. And I talk about that with Dr. Leah Robinson all the time. And we're trying to figure out, because classroom teachers don't necessarily have the skill set to teach motor skills, is there a way in which we can use activity breaks in the classroom to promote motor skills as well as physical activity? Usually that's in the domain of physical education, but I have been talking with Leah about, is there ways in which we can create videos for classrooms to be used where motor skills are actually being taught in just these short bursts that allows for development of movement. We are doing that a little bit with Impact at Home, because most of the teachers who made those videos for Detroit Public Television are PE teachers, and so they are teaching different skills, but we haven't assessed that yet, but we're excited to do that soon.
Great, and then Mark, the second part of Mike's question is, are the effects of impact on physiological responses long lasting?
That's a great question, and that is the primary specific aims of our R01 grant. So we are resubmitting that in July, and it's a randomized controlled trial to test the effectiveness of impact over an entire 9-month period. So we want to look at 9-month change, not only in physical activity, but in cardiometabolic risk factors such as BMI, heart rate, blood pressure, and cardiovascular fitness. So if that gets funded, I'll have an answer for you in 5 years.
Great. And then Wei-Yun Chen has a question. Wonderful presentation. Would you tell us more about your study promoting physical activity at home in terms of the intervention strategies and how to use the Detroit's TV public TV to promote this physical activity intervention?
Yes. So what we ended up doing over the summertime is and I have a presentation at American College of Sports Medicine. So for those of you who are interested, I'll be giving one of the president's lectures in May, where I'll go into more detail about how we transitioned the impact at school intervention into the impact at home intervention. And what we mainly had to do is use implementation science strategies to adapt the program for a home environment. And it was through funding that we got COVID CARES funding that enabled us to be able to produce some of the videos on Detroit Public Television and broadcast them there. It was why we decided to go the TV route is because we know that in this current environment, there is a huge disparity in internet access and that a third of our K-12 students do not have internet at home. So even if we had a freely available program that was housed on the SC website, that many kids still couldn't access it because they don't have streaming services at home. But as we partnered with television, and it's you don't even need cable, you don't need internet, it's publicly broadcasted. So it's available for all kids all throughout the state. And they are very open. They created this Michigan Learning Channel where all day they have learning opportunities and curriculum to kind of supplement what's going on in the classroom. And so they used Impact at Home to be kind of their physical activity at home. And that was a great opportunity for us to disseminate physical activity using that modality.
Yeah, that sounds great. And I've got another question, and there's if anybody else has a question. You know, I know that the asthma data at the end, you're still crunching the numbers, but I wasn't sure. It looked like the variance was greater, and for some of the, I think maybe it was enjoyment, and there was another thing for the children with asthma, and I wasn't sure if that was just a sample size or if you think there might be more variance in that subset versus the kids without asthma.
No, that's a good question. And I think we would definitely say yes, because I think there's more variability. It depends on most of the children with asthma, they were moderate to severe. So we recruited them from the asthma clinic with Toby Lewis's help. But some of those, even though they had moderate to severe asthma, it was really well controlled based on their asthma plan. And so some of them were athletes. And others didn't exercise at all. So I think there was a lot more variability in the physical activity levels within the asthma population compared to the children without asthma. When we looked at estimated their fitness level based on the 6-minute walk test, we didn't see any differences by group with fitness level, but we did see a lot more variation in the fitness level in the asthma students. So that could be explaining some of the differences or variability and enjoyment that we saw.
Okay, and I've got a question from Stacy Lynn Sant, who says, I enjoyed your talk and I learned a lot. Did you see any differences in physical activity and enjoyment based on sex or gender of the kids?
Excellent question, because no, we did not. And we are super excited about that because you will see differences in participation related to PE. So you see lower rates of PE, participation in PE in girls and lower enjoyment. You also see lower participation in physical activity during recess. But with classroom activity, we have not seen differences, gender disparities, and neither there's been a lot of other programs that have not seen gender disparities in physical activity. So maybe it's the type of physical activity. So we like to do a lot of Just Dance videos. We also will do the boys tend to like the fitness videos. I hate to sound gendered, but it was true. The boys like the fitness videos more. The girls like the dance videos more. I think because it was a structured and everyone was doing it at the same time and there was high enjoyment across everyone and there was a kind of a sense of community that was being built in the classroom, that we did not see any gender disparities in our first study in the 3 schools or in our second study in the low resource schools.
Okay, so I think that we're just about out of time. Our questions and time were calibrated perfectly. Really enjoyed it, Rebecca. Really interesting and exciting work. And it looks like the great thing too is there's so much ahead because you've really used the data you've gotten to really ask good questions for the future. We are recording this. I want to thank Devaney Rosebrock for helping to organize this virtual seminar. And thanks again to all the audience and have a wonderful rest of your day. Thank you. Bye-bye.